Lord, to come in a little bit later. We'll redeem the time, begin our service with prayer. If you're able, we'll ask for to stand. Let's invite the presence of the Lord in our midst tonight. Father, we are grateful to be back in the house of the Lord tonight. Lord, we're thankful for your many blessings upon us today. This is the day that you've made, and we rejoice, Lord, and we're glad in it. Along with the psalmist David, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I came with expectancy in my heart, Lord, for you to do something great in each and every heart and life. Lord, for you to work miracles where they're needed. Lord, for you to touch us and change us, mold us as clay in the potter's hand, conform us to your image, Lord Jesus, is our prayer. God, have your way in every song we sing, in the message that's preached, when we gather around this altar. Have your way in us tonight, is our prayer. We ask it together in Christ's name.
Thank you.
275 with us tonight. I'm anchored in Jesus. On life's boundless ocean, mighty billows flow. I fix my hope in Jesus, blessed anchor of my soul. The trials still assail me, it's forth to gather more. I rest upon His mercy and trust Him more. I'm anchored in Jesus, storms of life I brave. I'm anchored in Jesus, I'll fear the wind away. I'm anchored in Jesus, He had my say. I'm anchored in the rock of ages. Yes, I'm anchored in Jesus, the storms of life I brave. I'm anchored in Jesus, I'll fear the wind away. I'm anchored in Jesus, He had my say. I'm anchored in the rock. Let's sing page 393, When We All Get to Heaven.
Yeah.
I'm on my way to the city whose builder and maker is the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Be all right with me if it comes tonight. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy.
We'll be right back.
tonight. Thank God for the hope and the promise we've got. Heaven, if in this life only I had hope, I'd be a miserable man. Thank God there's something better waiting for us on the other side. Amen. You can be saved. We're going to ask our ushers if they would to come. Wait upon us. We worship the Lord with our giving tonight. Appreciate you. If you weren't here Sunday, give you an opportunity to worship the Lord with your giving tonight. We appreciate you for your faithfulness and giving unto the Lord. I ask Brother Daniel Rod if he would ask the Lord to bless the offering.
Song says forgiven when mercy walked in. Amen. And I'm so thankful. Amen. Mercy did walk in and plead my case. Brought to the stand God's saving grace. Hallelujah. Going to give you an opportunity and a chance to testify. leave your testimony in the house of the Lord. Ask Brother Butch if he will to stand. Testify for us. Yes, sir. Steve testified for us.
I'm thankful for Jesus, and I'm thankful he mentioned mercy, and I was thinking about his mercy a lot today for some reason, and I'm just thankful for his mercy that a long time ago he showed me his mercy and allowed me to accept him as my Savior, even when I didn't know what I was looking for, didn't know that I needed a Savior, but I'm thankful for the goodness of God, and you recently preached on the verses of the prodigal son, and that's I've heard many sermons in the last 6 months on the prodigal son. Some really good, some devotions that were just okay, and then some that were just like it's no big deal. But it's to me, they're some of my favorite verses in the Bible. When something I studied on a long time ago, when he went to his father and said, I want my inheritance. I don't know how the law was back then and how everything legally worked, but he really said, by law, by legal, he was saying that his father was dead to him, gone, dead and gone. And his father gave him what was his. And he didn't have a big RV and a pickup truck and everything to give to him. He left with some of the things you preached on. He left with a robe that identified who he was, what family he was from, a ring on his finger that he could do business with, that that was something that was very important, and then the shoes on his feet. And when he went away, it says he squandered all that. It was gone. It was gone. It was no more. Somebody else had it. And he didn't have any of that anymore. He was willing to go back to his father and just be one of his servants, because he knew he could never be his son again. By law, he couldn't, somehow, I don't know how that worked, but when he went back, his father was watching for him and saw him, and what did he say? He said, get a ring and put it on his finger, and he said, get him a robe. He didn't just say, get him a robe, he said, get the best robe and put it on him, and that's what really I've been thinking about a lot, about the goodness of God. Yeah. God wants us the best for us.
Right.
But what he really wants for us is his very best.
Amen.
The very best. If we settle for the best, that's on us, and it's all good. But man, he wants us to have his very best.
Yeah.
And I'm just thankful for all he's done for me and my family, and kept us all these years, and I'm just really thankful for the goodness of God.
Yeah.
And thanks for preaching on that a couple weeks ago.
As the Lord, brother, that's good. God wants to give us his very best, and he gave us his very best when he gave us his son. Amen. The absolute best thing that he could ever give. Amen. I'm thankful for Jesus tonight. Somebody else want to testify? Brother Homer. I remember we had just a little old aluminum boat, and I was just a teenager. We'd gone out, had a pond by my house. I could cast anywhere I wanted to on that pond from the bank, but it wouldn't do me but to just put the boat in the pond, amen, to go out. And my first time going out, I learned two very valuable lessons. Number one, you got to have a good plug, because if not, you're going to sink. And once I was able to avoid that catastrophe, I went out and had an old concrete paint can full of concrete for my anchor. I threw the anchor overboard, and I sat there and watched as the rope slipped through my hands. Didn't have it tied to the boat. I learned not only do you need an anchor, but you need to be tied to the anchor. Amen. I'm glad to be tied to the anchor, Jesus Christ tonight, the anchor of my soul. Somebody else want to testify tonight? Still speaks to those that'll listen. He will lead us and guide us into truth. Anybody else want to testify tonight? Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise as Brother Eddie comes tonight.
So let's continue to be in prayer for the Sessions family as they lay Brother Judd to rest on Sunday. I still remember Brother Morgan and Sister Davis, both of which are in the Fairhope Hospital. Brother Eddie had a stent put in a temporal lobe area. I asked him, I said, where is that in your neck or on site? He said, up in my brain somewhere. They had run a stent and it was went from 90% block to, I think the doctor said he got it to 12%. So they were happy with that. So he was supposed to went to his mother's house today, and hopefully he'll be back in service with us on Sunday. So let's remember Brother Eddie Morris when we pray. I still remember Terry and Sister Linda as they care for Sister Linda's mom, Sister Jimmy, and ask God to give them strength to be able to take care of her. Still remember Sister Murphy, Sister Darlene, Rada, others that we know continue to need miracles in their body. Amen. We're going to read tonight from 2 Corinthians chapter number 10 and just one verse, verse number 4. Probably got it memorized by now. We've preached on it several times. And Lord willing, this will be the last message along this thought on the weapons of our warfare. Second Corinthians chapter 10 and verse number 4, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Amen. We started a number of weeks ago, and I didn't intend the first night for it to be a series, but it wound up being that, as every point became a message in and of itself. And I want to finish this series tonight. And we've preached a number of different weapons, but I want to preach tonight on the last one that God's dealt with me about to preach on. That is the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The baptism in the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for the word of God tonight. Lord, we just pray and ask and believe that you're going to move in this house, in every heart and in every life. Lord, it's imperative as believers that we be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. We be not drunk with wine where it is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. We be, oh God, cloaked upon. We be endued with power from on high. We receive the promise of the Father. Lord, that you died, rose again, ascended back to the Father's right hand, and prayed the Father that he would send us the Holy Ghost. God, I pray that we would know, not in doctrine and not in theology, but we would know by experience the power of the baptism in the Holy Ghost. God, that that very living and real power, God, would be flowing in us and through us like rivers of living water. Grant it, we pray tonight. I ask you, Lord, if there's one here that's never been filled, my prayer tonight is, oh God, let us all leave this house full of the Holy Ghost and fire. Grant it, we pray, in Jesus' precious and mighty name. You love the Lord, would you say amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we talked, I think, message one on the wiles of the devil, and got familiar that we're in a battle, we're in a war, we're in a warfare, and then we talked secondly on the first weapon that we covered. If God indeed has given us weapons, he said the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. It sounds like to me God intends us to fight and God intends us to win. Yeah. Because he said the weapons I'm going to give you are mighty. Yeah. They're mighty through God for a reason, to the pulling down of strongholds, to crush, destroy, and defeat the devil. So that's what I want to do. I intend to win. Amen. By the help and the grace of God. When Jesus said it is finished, he gave us victory. We live vicariously through his power, through his grace, through his mercy. We live vicariously in his victory. Yes. And you've been given victory. You've been assured victory. And the only way you can be defeated is to quit. Is to just quit. It's just not believe. Unbelief won't allow you to enter in. Just as true as it was in the Old Testament, it's just as true. The writer said in the book of Hebrews that we should be careful lest we should depart from the living God through an evil heart of unbelief. And that's the only way you can lose. It's the only way you're not going to win the victory. If you'll believe God, if you'll hold on, if you'll remain true to him, I can promise you he's going to remain true to you. Amen. And I can promise you he's not going to fail, not one word, not one jot, not one tittle, not one promise that he's ever made is he going to allow to fail. God is going to do what he said he would do. So the devil's tried to convince me a lot of times, you may as well just quit. That promise has worked for a lot of people, but it ain't going to work for you. Well, that's what the devil does. He lies. He's real good at his job. He's the best that there's ever been at lying. The Bible said he is the father of lies. And when he speaks a lie, he speaks his own. Whenever anything comes out of his mouth, it's a lie. So if the devil's talking to you, telling you can't make it, well, then know that you can. The devil's telling me or telling you that works for everybody else except you. Well, then you could just know it's going to work for you like it did for everybody else. Because he's a liar and everything he says is a lie. So we're assured victory, but he said we're going to have to fight. We're going to have to endure hardness. As a good soldier of Jesus Christ, we're going to have to fight the good fight of faith. We're going to have to lay hold on eternal life, meaning we're going to have to cling to it. Yeah. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Every promise is there for you, but you got to take it. And once you take it, the Bible said, to hold fast that no man take thy crown. Yeah. You got to fight hell a lot of times to keep it. You can get victory tonight, I'll tell you, wake up fighting hell to keep it tomorrow. Because something will try to take it away from you. Hallelujah to God. You're looking at me like you know that's right. Amen. The first weapon we talked about was his name, the name of Jesus. We talked about the Lord has given us his name, and he's given us the power and the authority to use it. Somebody on the phone with EMC today, and I said, I just sold a piece of property, and I've got a power pole and a water pump hooked up to that. We you know, just pay the bare minimum. It comes straight out of my checking account every month, $48 every month. We haven't used it since we bought the land. I just sold it, so I need to disconnect that. I need that taken out of my name. I don't want no more $48 a month coming out of my account. Well, it's in. Is Kim with you? I said, no, she ain't with me. Well, are you going to have to get her to call back? And I said, well, if she don't have a phone and she can't call back, you're going to have to take my word for it. I need to turn it off. Can't do it. It's against company policy. You got to have a POA, power of attorney. Man, that just makes me, that just makes me aggravated as I can be. But it reminded me that Jesus gave us power of attorney.
That's right.
There's a lot of power in a name.
Amen.
And you don't know how much power until you need it. And there's some things that you can't have, and there's some things that you won't ever see, you won't ever possess, and there's some things you can't do outside of being able to call on the name of the Lord. You can't be saved unless you call on the name of the Lord.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Well, I want to be saved. Somebody told me I could be saved. Well, who told you? Well, I don't know. But they told me I could be saved. Well, you got to believe on the name of the only begotten Son of God. Amen. And unto as many as believed on him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. I don't want to add to the scripture. Because the Bible said if I add to the scripture, he'll add to me the plagues that are written in the book. But he said, as many as believed on him, to them gave he power. And you might could just throw in parentheses of attorney. Power of attorney to become the sons of God. Jesus said, whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, he'll do it. I'll tell you, if you don't know Jesus, you have no authority to ask God for anything.
Amen.
Except for mercy and grace and a prayer of repentance. And still then, you got to know the name. The right name to call on. Man, that was a good message, but I don't want to re-preach that as much as I would like to. And then we preached on weaponized prayer and the power that there is in prayer. And James said, is any among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray. I like that.
Yeah.
Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick. Now you've got the name of the Lord, and then the way you invoke the name of the Lord, the way you use the power of attorney is in prayer. That's where you use the power of attorney. Every time. What good is it to have power of attorney if you ain't going to use it? And the way we use power of attorney, we use it with the Father. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus.
Yes, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
This one needs prayer for being sick. This one needs a miracle in their finance. This one needs a miracle in their marriage. And we're going to all pray to the same one for the same thing. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Help us. The Bible said that we enter boldly into the throne room of his grace that we may find help in our time of need.
Yes.
Thank God. We do that in prayer. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months, he prayed again. And the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. And we talked about Hezekiah. He spread that letter out before the Lord upon the altar. Sennacherib made threats. Other nations, other kings have prayed to their gods, and we wiped every one of them out. And your God's no different. You're no different. You go ahead and pray to your God, and we're going to wipe you out too. Hezekiah said, I want you to hear his threatenings, Lord. Hear. And he said, so that all the earth might know that you are God. I want you to take care of old Sennacherib. The Bible said when they woke up the next morning, there was 185,000 dead Assyrians out there on the battlefield. God had sent one angel and killed them all. God sent one angel and killed them all. Think about this. One angel slew 185,000. That was the equivalent of two atomic bombs in World War II. One angel killed 185,000 men. And Jesus said, when they come to arrest him, he said, you don't have any power except the power that's given to you of my Father. And he said, I just want to remind you of something, that if I wanted to, I could pray to my Father, and don't you think that he would send 12 legions of angels to come and fight for me if I ask him to? A legion was said to possibly be 6,000 in a Roman troop. If one angel could kill 185,000 men, think what 12 legions, 12 times 6, 72,000 angels could do. You do the math, it would be exactly twice the world's population today. It would be about 14 billion people that 12 legions of angels could wipe out. I want to tell you, Jesus was trying to say there is power in prayer. And you just need to watch it, buddy. Because you don't want me to pray to my Father. And you don't want him to dispatch no legion of angels against you, because it won't be good. Oh, Daniel, what did he do? When they were in dire straits, he said, I got to read the book of Jeremiah and discover we done been here 70 years. And Jeremiah said that God was going to visit us after 70 years and cause us to return back home. He said, so I sat down by the riverbank. I drank no wine. I ate no pleasant bread. I fasted for the space of 3 weeks. And God sent two angels. One, Gabriel, was a messenger. And he said, oh, Daniel, he said, you are highly favored and well-beloved of God. From the first day you set your heart to seek God through prayer and fasting, he heard your cry, and he has sent me to bring you the answer. But the prince of Persia, a demonic power assigned to this area, fault me from bringing you the answer. So God had to dispatch the second archangel, Michael. I'll tell you, Gabriel, he's a messenger. But Michael, if you pray and you get the Lord to dispatch Michael, I mean, somebody's going to get whipped. Woo! Devil! You let me pray long enough, and I can get my God to send Michael, you're going to total whooping, old boy. He is going to whoop you. It ain't going to be good. That's right. I said whoop. And then the third weapon we talked about, weaponized worship. We mentioned Abraham. And then also Job. That true biblical worship is a type of sacrifice and surrender, and both of those men knew well what that was. We talked about also not only weaponized worship, we made mention of weaponized preaching. Man, that was fun for me to preach about preaching. We used Acts chapter 3, a man who was, you know, always making some kind of mistake by something he said. He denied Christ 3 times. He denied him so vehemently that he cursed. One time he put his foot in his mouth. He said, I tell you what. He said, I'm so loyal. I'm so faithful. I'm so committed. I'm so dedicated. I don't care who were to come and do or say what. I would never turn my back on you. Ever. He said, before the cock crows, you will have denied me 3 times. He said, no, I'll go to prison. I'll die, whatever. Before that cock crew, the next morning, he had done denied him 3 times. He went out and wept bitterly, but on the day of Pentecost. I'm leading to this last weapon. A man full of the Holy Ghost. Yes. Woo, hallelujah. When you mix preaching with the anointing of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
What a formidable weapon that God has in his hand. But preaching, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching that men might be saved. The word preach means a heralder, somebody who goes in the street and cries and makes public announcements. He said, what I tell you in secret, preach it or declare it from the rooftop. This gospel is not meant to be in a corner. Hallelujah. This gospel's not meant to be in a corner. Preach it in the church. Preach it in the jail. Preach it in a convalescent home. Preach it in a rehab. Preach it on the street. Preach it on your job. Preach it at the school. Preach it in your living room. It is meant to be preached. And when this gospel has been preached in all the world for a witness unto me, then shall the end come. You think about what we talked about, the difference that preaching has made through generations of time. Think about, had Joe Biden been raised up under a Holy Ghost filled, anointed preacher. Think about how different his life could have been, how different our country might be had one Barack Obama had the privilege of sitting under a Holy Ghost anointed preacher. Things could have been different. Do you hear me? Hallelujah. You see the beginning of our country. Do you know what the difference was? Men sat under real preaching, and it shaped their heart and life, and it shaped the nation. Where there's a lack of true biblical anointed preaching, the people are going to perish, and a nation will perish with it. Brother Clinton said, whenever I go to a camp meeting, I see young men or young women lined across the front row that have been newly, freshly anointed, baptized in the Holy Ghost and called to preach. I know God hasn't given up on the human race. There's still hope for the world when God is commissioning men and women to preach.
Amen.
Amen. Then we went on from there, preached on anoint or weaponized communion and fellowship. He ordered us not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but all the more as we see the day approaching. Talked about those redwood trees and their roots. They don't go real deep, but they reach real wide. And they tie around the other redwood trees and wrap and intertwine all with each other. And in order to blow one redwood down, you'd have to blow the whole forest down because they're all locked together. Man, when I read that, I said, Lord, that's the church. That's the way it ought to be. We're united as a family of God in Jesus Christ.
Right.
You get people praying together, studying and worshiping and seeking God and rejoicing in God and praying one for another. One of them gets low, one of them gets sick, one of them gets discouraged, one of them feels defeated, one of them's in the valley, the other one's on the mountaintop and just pulls them on up. One of them feels low or discouraged or defeated, the other, their brother, their sister's calling and say, hey, we love you, we miss you, we want you to come on back, hang in here with me, you're going to make it. I look back when we first got saved at Forts Lake, Brother Jerry Sessions, that's Brother Judd's dad. Maybe the second or third Sunday, he walked up to me and he said, man, we're just so thankful y'all are coming. He said, I want to invite you to eat lunch with us next Sunday morning when you come. My wife's going to cook. We want y'all to come over and eat lunch with us, spend the day. Just, you know, you can just stay on through, be here for Sunday night. All right, thank you. Different families after that, I know what they did. They all, you know, talked to each other. We're going to have them this week. Somebody else said, we'll get them the week after that. We lived an hour away. You know, somebody said, well, they ain't going to come here. They got to drive an hour just to get to church. Well, they was determined that we was going to come there. You want to know how? They was going to make us a part of the family.
Right.
that's going to just pull us right on in and love us. Brother Tim said, we'll treat you so many ways till you'll like one of them and want to come back. Brother Tim, Sister Ruthie had us over. Sessions had us over. Brother Sessions' daughter, Sister Jerry Lynn, her husband John, they had us over. Man, it was just every week until we was plugged in. That was our family. We wasn't going to go nowhere. An hour, so what?
That's right.
We drive an hour to go to work, don't we?
Come on.
We was driving an hour to go to church. So what? It was our church. It was a good church. And it became our family. And they're still our family today. A lot of them's gone to, I've been saved this year, this coming up year, 31 years. But over 30 years, a lot of them's gone to heaven now. All the gray tops, they're gone to heaven. And I'm a gray top now. Hallelujah. And if somebody wait 30 years, I'll probably be gone to heaven. Thank you, Brother Joey.
Yeah.
I'm glad Brother Joey thinks I'm going to heaven anyway. This weaponized fellowship and communion is harder for a man or woman to backslide when they plugged in to a family of believers.
Right.
We're accountable to God, and then we're accountable to each other. Love God, that's the first and greatest commandment. And what's the second one? Love your neighbor as yourself. All 10 commandments are bound up in them two.
Yeah.
Love God, and then love your neighbor as yourself. If you love God, you're accountable to Him. I don't want to sin because I love Him and don't want to grieve Him. Number two, I don't want to sin. I don't want to backslide because, number one, I don't want to grieve God. Number two, I don't want to let my brothers down. I'm going to live right, look right, and act right, not only in church, but in Walmart, on the job, or wherever I go. Number one, I represent God and His kingdom. Number two, I represent you. Thank God. And then we talked about the Word of God as our weapon. Taking the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Sharper than any two-edged sword. Dividing asunder, joint and marrow, soul and spirit, a discerner of the heart. Or the discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. The Word of God. I'm telling you, when the devil came against Jesus, he just put him to flight with the Word of God. Get behind me, it's written. Get behind me, it's written. My mind's made up. My house is built on the Word of God. Jesus said, I liken unto a man that hears my word and keeps them as a wise builder that built his house upon a rock. When the wind blew, when the rain descended, when the flood waters beat against the house, it remained because it was built upon a rock. The Word of God is our defense. It is our weapon against all the attacks of the devil. And then we preach the last message on the blood. I plead the blood. He said, when I see the blood, I'll pass over you. We're washed by the blood. We're redeemed by the blood. Thank God. There ain't nothing the devil can do about it. There ain't nothing he can do with it. I'm blood bought. Amen.
Praise God.
I want to end up tonight with this thought, and it is a weapon, the baptism in the Holy Ghost.
Right.
I tell you, the devil would love for nobody else ever to be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Well, what's so important about it? Why do I need it? I'm doing pretty good. Yeah, but you need to do better. The Bible actually says there's none that doeth good, no, not one. But I'll tell you what the bit and bridle is that'll keep you on the path called straight. It's the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
If you don't believe that, he said, he, the Spirit of truth, when he has come, he will lead you and guide you into all truth. That's your bit and bridle right there. Don't go there. Don't go there. Go here. Or if you're going the wrong way and he needs you to turn around, he's going to pull you. Amen. You know what a bit is? It's, you put it in that horse's mouth, you slide his tongue in there. When you pull to the right, it pinches his tongue. Somebody pinches my tongue, I'll go that way too. I want to tell you, he's pinched my tongue a lot of times. Not just to turn me, but when I get ready to, well, if you're a horse, the bit's in your mouth, I was going to say the wrong thing, but when I get ready to neigh the wrong thing, you get that later. He'll pull the bit.
Come on.
There are a lot of times I like to say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Somebody takes that out of context about every day. There's a lot of times I like to have my say-so, but I'd like to put my 2 cents into the pot and give somebody a little piece of my mind. David said, bridle my tongue while I'm before the wicked. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God. There's sometimes that flesh wants to rise up. Holy Ghost just put his hand over your mouth. Don't say that. The Bible says speak words that edify, not words that gender strife, not words that bring confusion. Hello? You know, the Holy Ghost is good for a lot of things, not just speaking in tongues. He's good for speaking truth. He's good for speaking wisdom. He's good sometimes for when you don't need to speak, when you just need to hush.
That's right.
Ooh, he can give you a smile when you don't have one of your own. Somebody said, oh man, I'm putting on a fake smile. Well, if you got the baptism of the Holy Ghost, it ain't fake.
Right.
It's genuine. Because
yeah.
I do have the joy of the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
The joy of the Lord is my strength. Amen. You'll receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Why do I need the baptism of the Holy Ghost? For he is the power of God. And the Apostle Paul said, we have the mind of Christ. I want to tell you something else the Holy Ghost is. He is the mind of Christ. He knows the deep things of God. And when you don't know how to pray, or you don't even know what you need to be praying about, sometimes the Spirit of God will move upon you and he will intercede through you. Hallelujah. Ooh. Oh, more than one time he's interceded through me, and you know when he comes, and you know when he's burdened about something, you know when he's burdened for somebody, you know when he's the one carrying the load. I can tell you as a preacher, I know when he steps on the platform and he's the one that starts doing the preaching. I've been up here leading worship before, and I know when he steps on the platform and he takes over as the worship leader. Hallelujah! He's touched my heart and life before. He was the one laying hands. The Apostle Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet it's not I that lives, but it's Christ that lives in me. I want to tell you, it's that power of the Holy Ghost that manifests the resurrected Christ in your life. How was Christ living in him? By the power of the Holy Ghost. He said, for me to lay my hands on him is for Christ to lay his hands on him. How? By the Holy Ghost. He's been with you, but he's going to be in you. That's another comforter, the Holy Ghost. As Christ was to those apostles, the Holy Ghost is to us. Just as mighty, just as powerful, just as anointed. Oh, he's in us. He's in us. Somebody say, well, I'm just not a speaker. Neither am I. I want to tell you, if I'm not anointed to speak, I am not a speaker. I talk too slow. I talk with the worst Alabama country southern drawl of anybody you've ever met. You name somebody or show me somebody that's got a worse drawl than me. Let me hear somebody that talks slower than I do. I hear, that's the reason I don't listen to myself most of the time. Oh, Lord, you picked the wrong voice to give me to preach. But when the anointing comes, forget all of that. Jeremiah said, his word is in me like a fire down in my bones. And it comes out. Oh, I got to speak. I got to say something. I got to call on his name. Sometimes I got to praise him. Sometimes I got to speak up. Sometimes I don't need to say anything. This Holy Ghost I've talked about, you know, the blood saves me. Saves my soul. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I'm washed by the blood of the Lamb. The blood made me a new creature, regenerated me. But I want to tell you, the Holy Ghost empowered me to walk like a new creature. It was one thing to get the children of Israel out of Egypt, but it took a cloud by day, Brother Daniel, and a fire by night to keep Egypt out of them.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
That's good. Yeah.
Yes. You get a man out of Egypt, but you're going to have to get Egypt out of him. That's what the Holy Ghost does. He's the Spirit of truth. He leads us and guides us into all truth. He teaches us what Christ would do, what Christ would say. He empowers us to work the works that Christ worked while he was here. He said, the works that I do, greater shall you do, because I go to my Father. He said, if I go to my Father, I'm going to pray the Father. He'll send you another comforter, and you'll receive power after he's come upon you. The Apostle Paul gave a litmus of all the sufferings that he had to endure, and he got right down to the end of all them sufferings, and he said, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. I know we've used that. You know, we can accomplish this task. We can go here. We can do it. But he, if you take that in the context of how it was written, he's talking about all the sufferings that he was called upon to suffer for Christ. And he said, I can do all things. I know how to abound, and I know how to be abased. I know how to, you know, be full, and I know how to suffer hunger. I know how to be cold and warm, but I know how to suffer cold and nakedness. And he said, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. That's the power of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost will keep you when you need to be kept. You would want to quit in the flesh. You want to get discouraged. You want to, you know, just leave and do something else. I'm tired of doing this. I don't want to be here. I don't want to do this. I'd love to sometimes just punch a time clock and sit down in the easy chair and no more responsibility and no more burden. And you ain't got to do what you do till you show back up at work. But when you wake up with it and lay down with it and go to Walmart with it and everywhere you walk, you know you're the ambassador of Christ. There ain't no quitting. There ain't no time clock to punch. This is 24 hours a day. This is 7 days a week. This is 365 days a year. There ain't no time off. I'm on the battlefield for the Lord. There ain't nowhere to go. There ain't nothing else to do. There ain't no other gospel to preach. There ain't nothing else to be done but to pray through and let the Holy Ghost raise you up and make you more than a conqueror. That's all you can do. You ever been shot through? You ever bled out? It felt like sliding under the juniper tree and says, enough, God, let me die. Well, God sent Elijah an angel, gave him a cruise of water and baked him a cake and said, get your hide up out of the dirt. You going home? He ain't sent me no angel, Sister Bird. He sent me the Holy Ghost.
Right.
A lot of times. Picked me up, brother. Hold me right by the nape of my neck. Said, come on, boy. Just walk with me.
Yeah.
I feel like I can't walk. He just dragged me sometimes. Just dragged me. That's what it is sometimes to walk in the Spirit. You ain't walking in your own strength. He got you. He's got you. And when you don't have the strength to walk, I just see him. He got me by the collar, just dragging me. I ain't gonna let you go, boy. I ain't gonna let you go. I got you. There's sometimes I got a hold to him, Brother Daniel. So I ain't gonna turn you loose. Not until you bless me. That's when we go to war on our knees and we lay hold of God.
Right.
We take hold of him. The Bible said by his power, Jacob prevailed with God. That's the power that avails, that God has availed us to pray and to lay hold of him in prayer. That's the Holy Ghost giving you strength to lay hold of God. And then there's some days, like it or not, you can act like a tough guy if you want to. There's some days, like it or not, you ain't got no strength to grip left in your hands, and you want to let go. And that's when he grabs you. So that's all right, boy. You held on to me last time, but I'm holding on to you this time. And I love you too much to leave you in the valley. I love you too much to let you lay around and wallow in self-pity. I'm going to carry you to the mountain with me, and you're coming back down with a victory. Hallelujah to God. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Ghost, the blood saved my soul. The Holy Ghost has saved my life. I said, the Holy Ghost has saved my life. He said, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will also quicken. He said, your mortal body by his Spirit that dwells in you. My mortal body, Brother Daniel, he saved me alive more than once. We're about to go back to Africa next week. I went to the Congo. I've told you that story 100 times. That mob marched down the street armed with AK-47s and done killed 2 government guards, and they wanted to kill 5 Americans. Nothing between us but a metal gate, a chain, and a lock. We all joined hands, began to pray. And I'm going to tell you, it was a Pentecostal prayer meeting too. The Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost came into that room. I don't know how long we prayed, because I was transported out of there into the spirit realm. When I came to myself, that mob was pushed on down the road. I could hear stun grenades going off, and they were firing shotgun rounds at them, rubber bullets, pushing them down the road. Somebody said, the UN saved y'all. I said, no, that's the Holy Ghost.
Yeah,
saved my life.
Yeah, Lord.
I was in the Philippines, sicker than I ever been. Cipro wouldn't touch what I had. Oh, I was so sick. If I took one sip of water, I'd immediately have to get up and go straight to the bathroom. Never had anything like it. It was like a sword. Somebody had stabbed my sword with a belly, and it's like they was churning it around. I was in so much pain. For 2 days, I laid in that room, let them preach, let them go, and let them do. I was so dehydrated. I'd been 2 days, I wouldn't drink. I couldn't eat, but I would not drink because I knew I'd be right back in that bathroom. When I knew I was about to black out, I'm dehydrated to the point where I need an IV. We're up in the mountains, a 3-hour drive from anywhere. I can't sleep. I'm sick of the dog. That little place we was at had Wi-Fi. I said, Brother Hanks, I'm going to do something that I don't normally do. I said, I'm going to use my Wi-Fi and I'm going to call my wife. It was wee hours of the morning for us, but it was, you know, afternoon here. And I called her and I said, I don't need you to panic. I just need you to listen to me. I'm sick. I'm bad sick. I feel like I'm going to die. But I don't need you to cry about it. I need you to get online. I need you to post on my page, on your page, on the church's page. I need everybody that I know that knows how to pray to start praying right now because I need the Lord to heal me. I'm going to say, when you get off, when you get from doing that and you get off the phone from me, you call Mike Howe. He lived in that parsonage right next to that church. I said, you call Mike Howe. Michael is his name, kind of like that archangel. An old Mike Howe goes out there in that church and starts praying, and the devil's about to take a whipping. That's just the way. And I knew he was going to pray for me. I said, you tell Mike Howe, I'm bad, sick, sicker than I ever been in my life, and I need a miracle. And I need him to pray now. And she said, okay. She said, please call me back when you get to feeling better. I hung that phone up. It's 2:00 in the morning. I laid back down in that bed and I'm rubbing my stomach. I'm crying. Oh God. Oh God. In about 30 minutes, it was like somebody took that sword out. It was like a healing balm passed over my stomach. I sat straight up in that bed. Brother Hank sat up with me and he said, you okay, Brother Eddie? Need me to help you to the bathroom? Because I was so weak, I couldn't walk. Need me to help you to the bathroom? I said, Brother Hank, I'm healed. Hallelujah. Somebody just touched someone.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. This Holy Ghost has saved my life.
Hallelujah.
I can't tell you the time, number of times that I've preached under the power of the Holy Ghost, and somebody come out in pews from where you sit, pull me off to the side. You said the very thing me and my wife said to each other before we came to church. I said, it wasn't me. It was God. He knows. He knows what we need to hear. He knows what we need to have. He knows what we need and what we don't need. I can tell you why the devil don't want you to have the Holy Ghost. Because he is the mind of Christ and he is the power of God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen. We all need to be filled with the Holy Ghost.
Nice.
I know you believe in it and you wouldn't be here. I know it don't scare you when I speak in other tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. But you don't need to be satisfied with me, with it flowing through me.
Right.
You need to pray until he flows through you.
Right.
How do you get the baptism of the Holy Ghost? You ask and seek and knock. Same way you get saved, you ask. Same way you get healed, you ask. That's how you get healed. You ask and you keep on asking. Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe and you shall receive them. Ask. I know this Holy Ghost is for me. I know you died, rose again, and prayed the Father that he would send it. It's been sent. It's a gift given unto the church. It's mine. I want it. I'm here to get it, and I'm going to seek it and ask for it every time I walk through the door until I do. He said a certain widow woman came to an unjust judge and said, every single day, avenge me, avenge me, avenge me. He said, I don't fear man, or I don't regard man, I don't fear God. This woman's wearing me out. I'm going to give her what she wants. He said, how much more will your heavenly Father avenge his elect who cry and seeking day and night? He said, nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Will he find the people that won't quit until they get the answer? They'll pray and keep praying until the Holy Ghost falls. That's the only way I know to get filled. I saw it every day of my life, multiple intervals throughout the day for 2 months until I got filled. Brother Harold Hanks said, I sought it 2 years before I ever got filled. But he's filled tonight. I'm filled tonight. And if you want to be filled, it might be 2 hours, 2 minutes, 2 days, 2 months, 2 weeks, 2 years. I don't care. But if you'll ask, he'll do it. And when he baptizes you in the Holy Ghost, the church will be better off for it. This world will be better off for it. Your job will be better off for it. Your family, your children, and you. You'll be a better husband. You'll be a better poppy. You'll be a better whatever it is God's called you to be. You'll be better for it. This is the weapon Jesus gave 12 men. I've called you. I've chosen you. You're clean by the word that I've spoken to you. Your mind, you're not of this world, but you stay until you get full of the Holy Ghost and you receive power when he's come upon you. 12 men stayed and convinced 100 plus more to stay with them. And they all came out of that upper room full of the Holy Ghost. I got filled with the Holy Ghost in Pascagoula, Mississippi. Where'd you get it, Sister Burke?
In High Springs, Florida.
Brother Daniel got it in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee. Where'd you get the Holy Ghost at, Brother Holmes?
Somerdale.
On the side of the road or somewhere, didn't you? Sister Becky got it at Somerdale Assembly.
I got it at Stapleton Church of God.
Brother Joe, where'd you get it at?
Foley Church of God.
Brother Corey, where'd you get it at?
Birmingham.
Somebody needs to get it at Bible Way. It'd be all right if you got it tonight. I didn't get it the first time at Bible Way, but I got it a bunch of times since then. Right here. Because the good thing about this, kind of like filling your car up, you just need it every time you need it. I said you need it every time you need it. It ain't just some one time in filling. It's every day. Somewhere along the way. Feel me. Feel me. Feel me. If you're able, stand with me all over this house.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. So imperative that you be filled. That's the infilling. It is so imperative that you be filled so that there's an outflow. Oh, God. This can't stay in here. This has to get out there. This has to get out there. That's the only way the church is going to reproduce after its own kind. Is that out of our belly, rivers of living water has to flow. Thanks be to God. How many of you meet me in this altar? You put both those hands in the air. You'll tell God, Lord, I need the power of the Holy Ghost, the infilling and the outflowing. Hallelujah. I need this same weapon you left the disciples with in the upper room.
Yes, granted, oh God.
Oh God.
Yes.
I don't want to just know about it in theology. I believe it because the Bible said it. I want to know it in experience. Taste and see that the Lord's good. That word taste in the Hebrews, where we get our word experience. Oh, experience this for yourself. That God is good. He is who He said He was. He'll do what He promised He'll do. This Holy Ghost is a reality.